Je vais pouvoir assez rapidement laisser la parole à notre premier conférencier, Dan Zahavi. Ravi de vous accueillir dans cette première matinée. Vous êtes professeur de philosophie à l'Université de Copenhague et à l'Université d'Oxford et directeur du Centre of Subjectivity Research à Copenhague. Et vous avez pour titre de conférence « Phénoménologie pure et appliquée ». Bienvenue, Dan, en vous souhaitant une excellente conférence. Vous connaissez la durée de la conférence. N'hésitez pas, je reviendrai vers vous s'il y a un petit décalage, mais en tout cas, nous aurons ensuite un certain nombre de questions à la suite de votre présentation.
So, the title of my talk is Pure and Applied Phenomenology. If we look at phenomenology as a philosophical tradition, I think it's fair to say that it has been a source of inspiration for a lot of disciplines outside academic philosophy, and that this is something that basically happened from the very start. I mean, already if we go to the first decade of the 20th century, we can find psychiatrists and experimental psychologists who were inspired by Husserl. And not long after, other disciplines joined in, for instance, sociology and anthropology. So it has been, I think, a very wide range of applications of phenomenology from the very start. And I think this is part of the reason why phenomenology has been so popular, I mean, probably more popular than at least some other philosophical traditions. One of the problems, though, is that there's really no consensus about how one ought to apply phenomenology. I mean, what method should one use in order to make the application phenomenological? What I want to do in the first part of my talk is to present to you some of the leading approaches within contemporary qualitative research. I want to talk a little bit about Jonathan Smith's interpretive phenomenological analysis, about Max van Manen's hermeneutic phenomenology, and about Amadeo Giorgi's descriptive phenomenological method. And I mean, these methods are widely used in a range of fields, including applied psychology, educational research, nursing studies, also educational research, as I said. So it's definitely worth looking closer at how these three theorists are really approaching the question of how best to apply phenomenology. If we start with Jonathan Smith, he at one point talks about what he calls IPA, interpretive phenomenological analysis, and claims that it's phenomenological because it aims, as he says, to explore the participants' view of the world and to adopt as far as possible an insider's perspective of the phenomenon under study, unquote. What is distinctive of Smith's approach is its ideographic focus. There's no interest in essential or eidetic structures, but rather his focus is on microanalysis of concrete cases. So what does that mean? Well, we are not really interested in a phenomenological analysis of what it means to be homeless in general, or what motherhood in general amounts to. No, our focus is on trying to understand how George experiences being homeless, or how Anna experiences being a mother. And of course, this focus on this ideographic focus is already something that sets Smith's approach apart from, say, a more traditional Husserlian approach. Now, Smith at some point also argues that human beings are always already engaged in interpretation, in interpretive meaning-making activities. And as he argues, part of the method of IPA is to let the researcher invite the participant to share an episode of sense-making. The researcher must act as a witness to this articulation. And finally, in a third step, the researcher must make sense of it. And Smith then argues that because IPA is committed to this tripartite structure, that this basically is evidence for the close affinity that interpretive phenomenological analysis has to Heidegger's hermeneutic phenomenology. Now, that might, of course, give rise to some questions. I mean, is there not more in Heidegger than this very coarse structure? But one might also perhaps raise the following question: is it really sufficient to be interested in the perspective of the agent or patient or client in order to make the approach in question phenomenological? I mean, is this not something that most approaches in qualitative research share? I mean, this interest in the perspective of the client. So if that is all there is to it, I mean, why is IPA then more phenomenological than other approaches in qualitative research? Now, Smith has replied that, or tried to elaborate what is distinctively phenomenological about IPA by arguing that IPA seeks to examine experience according to its own terms rather than according to predefined category systems. But one might again ask, is there not more to phenomenology than that? And at this point, Smith's reply is, well, you know, philosophers should not really come and ask these questions, because that seems to suggest that philosophy has some kind of monopoly on what phenomenology is, and that is not the case. Philosophy does not own phenomenology, as Smith says. And he also argues that philosophers have actually only formalized something all of us were already doing anyway. Now, again, this might leave people somewhat dissatisfied, and not surprisingly, it has also given rise to some severe criticism within the camp of qualitative researchers. So Van Manen, who I will be discussing next, has a couple of years ago criticized Smith and argued that Smith has basically hijacked the term phenomenology to gain more readers. I mean, that so basically Van Manen is arguing that Smith is not really doing phenomenology. He's also arguing that Smith's methodology is, and I'm quoting, hopelessly misrepresentative of phenomenology in any acceptable sense, unquote. And finally, Van Manen has insisted that the whole IPA program is far too shallow and superficial to qualify as phenomenological in the original sense of the term. So, I mean, it's not as if we really need to look at outsiders to find people we disagree with. I mean, there's obviously disagreement within the phenomenological camp itself. Now, what about Van Manen then? What does he claim phenomenology is all about? Well, he starts out by arguing that phenomenology is philosophical in nature and that it's very important for people who want to practice phenomenology and who want to apply phenomenology. It's very important for them to return to the origin and to consult, as he says, the primary literature, tradition, and movements of phenomenology. Now, how does Van Manen define the aim of the phenomenological investigation? Well, he says that phenomenology is the study of lived experience. It's the study of what an experience is like. He also argues that the basic phenomenological question is, what is that experience like? And when it comes to the nature of the phenomenological method, Van Manen argues that the basic method is the epoche and the reduction, and that we, by using these methods, are precisely able to grasp the phenomenological meaning of a human experience. Now, I think what is kind of distinctive here is the idea that the focus of the phenomenological investigation is very much on experience. So as he says, phenomenology is the study of the phenomena, and the phenomena are someone's experiences. So in a Husserlian framework, this would be characterized as a very noetic bias. I mean, there's a focus on the subjective component, but we don't really address or look at the worldly or objective pole of experience. And this is also highlighted in the following statement, where he says that Husserlian phenomenology is not concerned with the external object, but only with our experience of that object. Phenomenology doesn't study the what of our experience, but only the experience of that what. So there's, again, very much have subjective orientation. Now, among van Maanen's many publications, his 2014 book, Phenomenology of Practice, is the largest one, and it's one that has been praised in various reviews as offering a very substantial clarification of central phenomenological concepts and being very enlightening when it comes to its depiction of what it actually means to do phenomenological research. Now, as van Maanen points out in the introduction to this book, it's very important to present the project and method of phenomenology in a non-technical manner. I mean, if we really want to convey what phenomenology is about to people who are not trained philosophers. Now, how does van Maanen do that? Well, if we look at the methodology sections, van Maanen start by distinguishing what he calls the heuristic reduction, the hermeneutic reduction, the experiential reduction, and the methodological reduction. So it's not just the epoche and the reduction that we need to master if we want to practice phenomenology. We also need to understand the distinction between these four types of reduction. And it doesn't end there because he moves on to distinguish the eidetic reduction, the ontological reduction, the ethical reduction, the radical reduction, and the originary reduction. So now we have nine different reductions. He also talks about the revocative, evocative, invocative, convocative, and provocative method. And finally ends by distinguishing reduction, deduction, induction, production, production, abduction, and seduction. So this is all as part of a non-technical description of what phenomenological method is about. I mean, I'm sure you would all agree with me that it's getting pretty complicated by now. And I'm not convinced, I have to say that straight out, I'm not convinced that this is really comprehensible to people who are not trained philosophers. I mean, I have been working on phenomenology as a philosopher for 30 years, and I have no idea what van Maanen is talking about. So, but I mean, there might be some out there who knows what it is, but I don't. What about Georgi then, end with him? Now, Georgi, in contrast to both van Maanen and Smith, is particularly inspired by Husserl. He's particularly inspired by Husserl's work on phenomenological psychology. Just like van Maanen, Georgi claims that if one wants to apply and use phenomenology, one has to understand its philosophical underpinnings. He talks about the overarching aim of phenomenology to be that of offering faithful descriptions of the essential structures of lived experience. And then he distinguishes three steps. On the one hand, it's important to use the phenomenological reduction. What does that mean? It means that we shouldn't posit as existing any object or state of affairs. We should just focus on what is given, explore that, and not be pulled in by the object. Secondly, the approach has to be descriptive. It must not be explanatory or interpretative. So we should focus on what is being experienced by the experiencer without adding or subtracting anything. And finally, and again, this is a clear difference to Jonathan Smith, Georgi wants to say that the focus has to be on invariant structures. So we're not just dealing with ideographic cases. Now, to just emphasize the importance of the reduction once more, Georgi insists that if one wants to employ something like a phenomenological method within the human sciences, well, then it is essential that the researcher brackets or disengage from all past theories and knowledge about the phenomenon, and again withholds existential assent of the phenomenon. So this is the question of the reduction. He also says that it's essential that the researcher assumes the attitude of the phenomenological reduction which means that she must persist from positing as existing whatever object or state of affairs is present to her. The researcher still considers what is given to her, but she treats it as something that is present to her consciousness, and she refrains from saying that it actually is the way it presents itself to her. So again, to kind of make the point just once more, unless the research is supported by the reduction, it cannot claim phenomenological status. Okay, I've just presented three different takes on what phenomenology in practice amounts to, how one might use the phenomenological method outside of philosophy. And I think it's now time to kind of raise a more general question, namely, how pure must this application be? Now, as we have seen, both Van Manen and Georgi talks about how anybody who wants to practice phenomenology needs to perform the epoche and use the reduction. And I just have to say that to kind of simplify matters, I'm using the terms epoche and reduction interchangeably here. I don't think it, for our purposes, is very important to distinguish them. I think one can do that, but bear with me and accept that I'm just using them synonymously for the purpose of this talk. Now, why exactly is it that we need to perform the epoche and the reduction? And I think that if one looks in the qualitative research literature, there are two different reasons being given. The first reason is that phenomenology involves an inward turn. So we need to perform the epoche in order to be able to attend in a proper and attentive manner to experience. And so what is it that we should perform the epoche about? Well, we have basically to bracket or suspend our occupation with objects. And I think this motivation is very clear, for instance, in the work of Van Manen. We shouldn't concern ourselves with the objects, but really just study the experience. The other explanation that is often given is that phenomenology is descriptive rather than interpretative. So we need to perform the epoche in order to be able to return to the thing itself. And what is that that we need to bracket? It's basically all kinds of theoretical presuppositions and prejudices. So I think these two reasons are very widespread. They're often given in the literature, but I actually think that they are wrong. And let me try to explain that in some detail. So let's consider first the issue of description. I mean, the question to ask again is, do we really need the epoche if we want to attend to experience? Well, consider the fact that there are other people who have offered careful descriptions of experience without using anything like the epoche or the reduction. Brentano's descriptive psychology is one example. Another example could be introspectionism. I mean, just think about James's work, The Principles of Psychology. Careful descriptions of experiences, no use of the epoche. But even more importantly, let's look at Husserl's logic and investigations. What do we find there? Find a very careful analysis of different intentional experiences. It's also in the logic and investigations that Husserl urges us to return to the things themselves. But there's no reference to the epoche and the reduction in the first edition of that work. What about Adolf Reinach, who was one of Husserl's early followers? Just before the outbreak of World War I, Reinach gave a lecture called What is Phenomenology? And as Reinach makes clear in this lecture, phenomenology is a particular philosophical attitude. It's not just a system of theoretical propositions. Now, what characterizes this attitude? Well, the way Reinach talks about it, the purpose of the attitude is that it focuses on the essence of the object under investigation. So it ignores the particularity of the object and tries to grasp the eidos, or the essence. Now, interestingly, in his lecture, Rainer gives different examples of what phenomenologists might investigate. He starts out by structures of experience, but then he moves on and says that there are all kinds of other things that phenomenologists could also investigate, including time and space and numbers and concepts. So again, there's a clear difference between Reinach's depiction of what phenomenology is about and, say, Van Manen's, who argued that phenomenology is only interested in experience. Now, towards the end of the lecture, Reinach concludes by arguing that phenomenology must return to the things themselves, and he then describes this as a turning away from theories and constructions in order to rely on intuition. And again, what is revealing here is that there's absolutely no reference to the epoche and the reduction in Reinach's text. And that, of course, starts to make it a bit problematic to argue that the epoche and the reduction is just the phenomenological method, as if all phenomenologists were in agreement on this. I mean, this is clearly not the case, and I don't even have time to talk about post-Husserlian phenomenology. But I mean, even if one goes to early phenomenology, they didn't talk about the epoche and the reduction. Now, of course, one interesting question is, well, why didn't they do so? And I think that the explanation is pretty straightforward. The reason why the early Husserl and Reinach did not talk about the epoche and the reduction was because they were not engaged in what is called transcendental phenomenology. Now, Husserl only started introducing these concepts when he made the move from his early descriptive phenomenology to his later transcendental phenomenology. And I mean, don't get worried if this sounds complicated. I'll try to make it clear what exactly is at stake here. According to Husserl, phenomenology is not ultimately about describing consciousness. Phenomenology, the aim of phenomenology, is basically to answer a number of very fundamental philosophical questions. Some of these philosophical questions are questions pertaining to epistemology and metaphysics. And Husserl is basically arguing that we cannot address and answer these questions in a sufficiently radical manner if we simply presuppose, a number of metaphysical assumptions. So if we are to address these questions radically, we need to bracket those metaphysical assumptions. And it's precisely in this context that the epoche becomes important, because the point of the epoche is not to bracket all kinds of theoretical assumptions, no, it is to target a very specific one. And let me give you a couple of quotes from Husserl's Ideas 1 and from Cartesian Meditations. So here's how Husserl introduces the epoche in Ideas 1. We put out of action the general positing, which belongs to the essence of the natural attitude. We parenthesize everything which that positing encompasses with respect to being. And a bit later, he says, he says, it's very important not to confuse or conflate this epoche with a kind of positivistic attitude, because it's not a matter of excluding all prejudices that cloud the pure objectivity of research. It's not a matter of constituting a science free of theories. So I just wanted to give you the final quote from Cartesian Meditations, where Husserl talks, he specifies that what we have to bracket is our concern with the being or non-being of the world. I mean, this is how he talks about the epoche. So to try to kind of summarize, the purpose of the epoche is to bracket what Husserl calls the natural attitude. What does that mean? What it means is that if we really want to engage with very fundamental philosophical questions, we cannot simply take it for given or granted that there is something like a mind-independent world. That's Husserl's view. And his point is that if we then perform the epoché and if we perform the reduction, we will be relieved from a certain metaphysical dogmatism, and that will then allow us to realize to what extent consciousness and truth and reality and being are all intertwined and interrelated. And it's on this basis that Husserl then claims that we will be able to accomplish the core goal of the phenomenologist, namely, and I'm quoting, this is from Crisis, namely to transform the universal obviousness of the being of the world, for him the greatest of all enigmas, into something intelligible. So what is Husserl saying? Husserl is saying if we want to understand the being of the world, then we need to perform the epoché in order, I mean, to kind of address this specific philosophical question. And the obvious question to ask at this point is, of course, the following. If you are a physiotherapist or a nurse or an occupational psychologist or an educator, and if you want to use phenomenology in your practice and in your research, are you then primarily interested in a transcendental clarification of the being of the world? And if the answer is no, which I presume it is, then I think you have to reconsider whether you really need to use the epoché and the reduction, because the purpose of the epoché and the reduction is precisely to allow for that kind of clarification. Now, I don't just think that it's kind of philosophically misguided to insist that anybody who wants to use phenomenology has to kind of take on these very heavy-duty concepts of epoché and reduction. I think that's a mistake, because I think the notions have a very specific and distinct philosophical function. And if you're not interested in that philosophical kind of enterprise, I don't think you need to bother with them. But I also have another argument for why I think it's problematic. And that is that insisting that you need to use them generates a lot of confusion, because people are trying to explain what the concepts mean. And these are admittedly complicated technical concepts. And what we then encounter in the literature is a lot of confusion. And let me just give you a couple of examples. So Langdrich, a psychologist, argues that the aim of the epoché is to transcend the noetic-noematic correlation and take a God's eye view on experience. I have no idea where Husserl should ever have said that we need somehow to take a God's eye view on experience. Paley, who actually is a critic of phenomenology, tries to explain here what the phenomenological reduction is by arguing that its aim is to break out of experience into the realm of pure consciousness. So we need to leave experience in favor of consciousness. Again, I have no idea what that's supposed to mean. Goudet and Robert has argued that Husserl's aim was to adopt a point of view from nowhere, for which reason his pursuit is similar to that of the positivists. Again, that's, I mean, seemingly a complete misunderstanding of the whole phenomenological enterprise if the idea is to erase one's own perspective. And as we have already seen, Van Manen, I mean, offers us 9 different reductions, which I also think is a big confusion. Now, this, of course, still leaves it open. How should we then proceed? And as I just said, I really think that if one wants to apply phenomenology outside of philosophy proper, it's best to forget about the epoché and the transcendental reduction. Now, I have to emphasize that this is not supposed to entail that non-philosophers are prohibited from making use of these concepts. I think there might be specific contexts where the concepts can actually play an important role. I think a very interesting example of this can be found in an older article by the German psychiatrist Wolfgang Blankenburg, where he argues that the psychiatrist might use the epoché in order to gain some understanding of the transformed being in the world of the psychiatric patient, especially the person suffering from schizophrenia. The idea here will be that in order to get a feeling for this very different way of being in the world, something as radical as the epoché might actually be called for. Another example might be in the field of phenomenological anthropology. If you want to understand a very different way of experiencing the world, say one where stones and trees are animated by spirits, again, perhaps something like the phenomenological epoché might be useful. But what I want to say, so I'm not saying that people are prohibited from using it, but I want to reject the idea that you cannot be said to be doing something phenomenological, I mean, if we're talking about a non-philosophical use, unless you use the epoché and the reduction. I just think that these are misguided statements. And again, if you are working as an educator or a nurse, I think it makes much more sense to suggest that your research should be guided and informed by phenomenological analysis of topics with direct clinical and interpersonal relevance. So to kind of summarize my finding, and then I will move towards my conclusion, I think there are kind of three dangers in much existing research. Either the research, the use of phenomenology is too superficial. It's just about paying attention to experience, but that certainly doesn't get to the heart of phenomenology. It can also be too philosophical in the sense that there are far too many philosophical concepts that are being drawn upon with very little obvious relevance. And finally, there's also this idea that there might be misguided methodological requirements, and where the claim is that people working, say, in qualitative research really has to adopt a very specific philosophical attitude. I also take that to be wrongheaded. But of course, the question is then, how should we proceed? And here my proposal is very straightforward. Why not learn from other successful applications of phenomenology? Because if we are looking at back in history, there are actually quite a number of important resources to draw upon. We might look at classical phenomenological psychology. We might look at phenomenological psychiatry. And we might also look at more recent attempts at using phenomenology within the cognitive sciences, which is often labeled naturalized phenomenology. And so let me try to give some examples of this, and then I will be done. So first, if we go back in history and look at some of the classical figures, Karl Jaspers, Katz, Strauss, Minkowski, Schütz, they were all inspired by Husserl's insistence on the importance of carefully attending to the phenomena. I think they were inspired by Husserl's insistence of retaining an open-minded attitude, not to be blinded by preconceived theories. In addition, many of them were also interested in specific phenomenological concepts, be it intentionality, embodiment, the life world, etc. But I think it's noticeable that very few of them were specifically drawing on the notions of epoché and reduction. I mean, that didn't really seem to play an important role. And I don't think it's coincidental that Herbert Spiegelberg, the big historian of the phenomenological movement, in the conclusion to one of his other books, which is called Phenomenology in Psychology and Psychiatry, explicitly warns against what he calls an orthodox return to Husserl. So Spiegelberg claims that one has to free oneself from some of the technicalities of Husserl's philosophy if a true two-way exchange between psychology and phenomenology is to be possible. And so let me give you a few examples. First, Binswanger. If you go back to Binswanger, who of course is primarily known as a psychiatrist, he actually wrote a book about psychology in 22, where he tried to make the case that phenomenology can make a difference. He argued that it can provide a better foundation for empirical psychology and psychiatry. How can it do that? Well, the example chosen by Binswanger is by offering a correct account of social cognition, one that avoids all kinds of references to projection and analogical inference. Indeed, as Binswanger was saying, if we recognize that the primary manifestation of another human being is in the form of an undivided psychophysical unity that is neither as a mere body nor as a pure mind, phenomenology can offer very important insights to psychology and psychiatry. And of course, interestingly, in his presentation of phenomenology, there is no reference to the epoche or to the phenomenological reduction. Then if we move forward in time, and of course, we have Gallagher presenting later this afternoon, there has been this attempt up through the 90s to draw on phenomenology for within the cognitive sciences. And the idea has been that if cognitive science is to make progress, it certainly has to deal also with consciousness. And if it is to do that, it should use methods designed to do so in an adequate manner, including those developed by Husserl and Merleau-Ponty. And let me here just point to one of Sean's articles, an article that came out in 2003 called Phenomenology and Experimental Design, where Gallagher is basically arguing that ideas from phenomenology can be used in the design of empirical investigations. So concepts taken from phenomenology or clarifications or distinctions found within phenomenology can operate as a partial framework for experimentation and also for interviewing. And again, this is not a focus on the epoche and the reduction. It's about taking specific distinctions, say, for instance, the distinction between sense of agency and sense of ownership, and then use that in experiments. So the whole, I mean, again, insights developed in phenomenology can help us design and set up empirical studies. And as a final example, let me mention work done by phenomenological psychiatrists in Copenhagen. If one looks at the qualitative research literature, one can occasionally come across the idea that what characterizes a phenomenological interview is that one doesn't really ask questions of the interviewee. Because if you ask questions, well, then you are trying to influence the subject that is being interviewed. And I realize this is a little bit of a caricature, but I mean, sometimes it's a little bit as if the idea is, well, we can just put a microphone on the table and then wait, and then hopefully the person being interviewed will offer all the nice and rich descriptions that we are interested in. The problem here, of course, is, I mean, what if the person being interviewed is not a master phenomenologist? What if they have little to say, are only able to offer very coarse and superficial descriptions? I mean, what should we then do? And here I think that a very different take on what a phenomenological interview amounts to has been developed by this group of primarily Danish psychiatrists who have developed something called the ease examination of anomalous self-experience, which is basically a checklist supposed to guide a systematic clinical exploration of experiential anomalies. And the checklist consists of 57 items. It's supposed to be used in semi-structured interviews. And importantly, the psychiatrist who is using this this method is really supposed to engage proactively and exploratively with the patient. So again, very different from a kind of hands-off perspective. By asking questions concerning specific dimensions or concerning specific structures of experience, they're able to elicit descriptions concerning domains to be of particular clinical relevance. And the dimensions that are being asked for and the experiential structures that are being investigated are precisely structures and dimensions that phenomenologists have traditionally highlighted as being crucial. So these might be relations, dimensions pertaining to temporality, to embodiment, to intersubjectivity, to self-experience, to intentionality, etc. So again, for this group of psychiatrists, using phenomenology is not just about eliciting first-person reports from the patients. It's not just about showing an interest in the person's in the patient's perspective. No, it's really about actively employing a comprehensive theoretical framework in the investigation. So to conclude, well, as I just said, I think it's misguided to simply identify phenomenology with some interest in the perspective of the client or patient or informant. I think one has to draw on theoretical notions, including notions such as life world, empathy, temporality, embodiment, sedimentation, habituality, anthropopoiety, and so on and so forth. I also think it's very important, I mean, not to be too, too focused on what the tradition has to offer. I mean, the value of that procedure has to be measured on the basis of the results it delivers, not on whether or not it accords with whatever Husserl or Heidegger might have said about the matter. So again, I really think that the phenomenological tools being employed must show their pertinence, must make a valuable difference, must allow for new insights, better therapeutic interventions. And if they can't do that, well, then I think you should find another method. I really think that the appeal to orthodoxy and purity and methodological rigor in this specific context is misplaced. And I mean, don't misunderstand me. My view would be somewhat different if we are talking about philosophy, but my focus here is on how to use phenomenology outside its kind of natural philosophical home. And so my conclusion, which might perhaps be provocative to some, is that if one really wants to apply phenomenology, I'm not sure the best way to proceed is to think about phenomenology as a distinct method. I really think it's more about a toolbox that can potentially be used in conjunction with a number of existing methods within, for instance, qualitative research. So thank you very much for your attention.